1, 2, 3, 4.
Good afternoon and welcome to the Booms and Bus Show. My name is Jonathan Davis. The Booms and Bus Show is about politics, economics and markets, as in investing for your secure and comfortable retirement. And we have a distinctly free market capitalist, freedom of speech, liberty, libertarian slant. Indeed, there are few who are more libertarian in my outlook, and I hope that this comes across. Why am I playing Give Peace a Chance by Lennon? Well, if anyone knows anything about the news blackout this weekend, then they'll understand why I'm talking about Lennon. But of course, it's got nothing to do with that, because on this week in history, in fact, on the 1st of June 1969, Lennon recorded Give Peace a Chance. On a four-track tape recorder in room 1742 at the Queen Elizabeth Hotel in Montreal. So nothing at all to do with the news or anyone who might have the name Lennon. Today is Monday, the 28th of May 2018. It's in fact a bank holiday in the United Kingdom, but I'm still doing this podcast, the Booms and Bus Show. Thank you to all those who have been listening to recent shows, who've been retweeting the tweet of each podcast, and indeed who have gone on to iTunes and rated the show out of 5 stars. I really appreciate it. Just to let you know, we're getting slightly increasing number of listeners, of downloads, week after week. The rate of ascent remains very shallow, but it's an ascent rather than a descent, so that's obviously good news. Also, what is good news, which I think will translate into more people listening, is that there's now how many Twitter followers? 440, still a tiny number, who follow the Booms Busts Show Twitter account, at Booms Busts Show. But for whatever reason, we seem to have been stuck around 300 for months. So clearly that's gone up 50%, still a small number. But there are more and more, it's clear, who are finding out about the show, the Twitter account. And I see no reason why by the end of the year there won't be 1,000 people following the Booms Bus Show Twitter account, and that should translate to more and more people who listen to the show. And if you're a regular listener to the Booms and Bus Show, then I'm sure you'll be happy that more and more are joining you. So there was a day for freedom which took place, I think, at the end of April or beginning of May in Downing Street. I'd like to point out that there's going to be another one. What is that? This Saturday, the 2nd of June in Manchester at 1 p.m. in the All Saints Park. And the Day for Freedom, the people attending will be marching against terrorism, fascism, racism and government inaction in the UK. Join the two leading groups fighting all forms of extremism, and their Twitter accounts are at TrueFLA, TrueFLA and VTerrorism. So that's Manchester, 2nd of June, 1 p.m. David Curtin from UKIP put it very well on Twitter. UK 2018 equals 1984. A man known as XXXXXXX has disappeared after campaigning for children to be protected from XXXXXXXX. His location is unknown and his safety is in grave danger, yet the press is not allowed to talk about his case. Kay Wilson, who tweets under at Kish Kush K, I cannot recall a case in British legal history where someone was arrested and within 4 hours imprisoned for 13 months, followed by a government media blackout, and all for the crime of live streaming on Facebook about gang rapes of British girls. Another person said, some say Tommy Robinson broke law. Here's others who broke law. Nelson Mandela, Martin Luther King, Mahatma Gandhi, the French Resistance, Kaza Rooney is her Twitter account. I've just been called a racist bigot for sticking up for Tommy Robinson. I can't believe people are being called racists for sticking up for the rights of children who are being abused and raped by these men. When did it become acceptable in the UK to support known paedophiles? We're told that Mohan Singh was in court in Leeds for the verdicts on 29 men for a child sexual exploitation case from Huddersfield. Officials politely asked him to leave as the defendants felt intimidated. I bet the 11-year-old raped girls felt intimidated. We know now that there are nearly 300,000 online signatures for a free Tommy Robinson petition. From Friday. That is fantastic. Let's get it to 1 million and the politicians will still ignore it. That's what's been going on this weekend. It'll be interesting to find out if anyone does anything to me. Wouldn't that be interesting? A mother who tricked her daughter into going on holiday to Pakistan then made her marry a man who had taken her virginity when she was 13 has become the first woman in Britain to be convicted of forced marriage. For which, of course, we are thankful and we are very pleased to hear it. The girl is now 19. She's described as vulnerable. I'll bet. She was then flown to Pakistan under the pretext of a family holiday and was made to marry the man 16 years older than her. This is not a man. This girl wept throughout the wedding ceremony. Her mother, who is 45, and cannot be named for legal reasons. Why not? The girl is 19. Why can the mother not be named for legal reasons? She planned the marriage and threatened her daughter with black magic and spirits if she spoke out. She told her daughter that she had, quote, no choice, unquote, and that it was a, quote, cultural matter. That so-called woman, who clearly loves her culture more than her family, or should I say loves her culture and family more than her daughter, got ostensibly 4.5 years, which means she'll be out in 2. I'm very glad this mother has been jailed. She'll only serve 2 years, I imagine. It's not nearly enough for the real crime here, which was to aid and abet a man of 29 to rape her just turned teenager daughter. And what about the convictions for female genital mutilation? Thousands of young girls are mutilated every year in the UK alone. They've even set up centres to help these girls after it's happened, as if that's going to sort the problem. No, what that's doing is condoning the problem. Do you know how many convictions there are in the UK every year? Zero. They moved quick enough to get rid of a reporter, but they clearly are never moving to sort out our girls. And when I say our girls, I don't just mean the young white girls who have been raped and mutilated and drugged and killed for the last 20 years. I'm talking about our girls in Britain who are mutilated by their so-called loving families. They are our girls as well. So I watched on YouTube the BBC, Joe Coburn, quizzing Jacob Rees-Mogg about his Catholic beliefs, and the insinuation was that he could not be a senior politician with Catholic beliefs. Remind me, listener, when was the last or even first time you heard an interviewer question Sadiq Khan with the same fervour about his religious beliefs? And he is one of the most senior politicians in the United Kingdom. Right, let's move on to other matters. I can't remember, but I know I've spoken about it. I don't know if, however, I've said it on the Booms and Bus show, that China has been developing for the last couple of years an absolutely terrifying, what they call, social credit system, whereby their algorithms determine whether or not you, what score you get for being a member of the Chinese society. And the lower score that you get, you will be forbidden from taking an airplane flight, for travelling on a high-speed train, from being able to work in the public sector, and other things. Well, I have read that the social credit system has already, I didn't even know it was up and running, it's already blocked 11 million Chinese from flying. Has no one ever watched a dystopian science fiction movie? And this weekend in Swansea, just below the valleys, down in the mumbles, you had the BBC's biggest weekend, is what they called it. South Wales police have been using live facial recognition. They're scanning everyone's faces and their picture, your picture if you attended, may be taken and kept for a month or more. Do contact Big Brother Watch if you want to discuss or if you feel you've been affected. Big Brother Watch. As David Curtin said, 2018 in the UK equals 1984. And if you think it's going to get any better, not while you don't have a free market, libertarian, capitalist government. It ain't going to get any better. There is a libertarian or a couple of libertarian parties in the UK. Clearly, they're one man and his dog type operations, and I gather they're jokes. However, if 100 of you wanted to take over the Libertarian Party in the UK, I would certainly join in. Absolutely 100%. I would give a great deal to such an organisation. If even 10 of you wanted to get involved, I'm sure we could make a quorum. I'm sure we could we could overthrow the committee, by the normal meeting rules. I'm sure we could take the thing forward and become a political force. And I'd happily team up debate and presentation events with For Britain and UKIP, but clearly they're not free market capitalist organisations, but at least they've got pretty well their hearts in the right place. So the fascist Maduro in Venezuela was, of course, re-elected as president of his undemocratic socialist state. he gets to be president for another 7 years. And just go on Google and find Maduro victoriously waving, to a crowd with music, successful music in the background. He's waving happily. His team are around him, and he's looking at this crowd. It must have been an amazing event. What was it? He was in the main plaza in Caracas, and he was waving to an empty plaza. There was literally no one there apart from his acolytes. And of course, it was all for socialist, communist, fascist show. Just like in North Korea, just like in the east of Europe, until relatively recently, the cameras were looking at Maduro with a fantastic backdrop, and he's smiling and he's waving, and everyone around him is smiling and happy. And they're looking up to him like a demigod. And they're literally looking at an empty plaza. You know, they say, the Labour Party and all that crowd say, but it's not real socialism. And, you know, they say it time and time again, whenever those socialist states break up and break society and break economies. Do you ever hear anyone say, yeah, but it wasn't real Nazism? No, you don't. massive thumbs up and congratulations and plaudits go to a politician by the name of Andrea Jenkins, of whom I had never heard. She has just resigned from a junior role in the government. She was appointed just in January. She's just resigned. Why? Because she's on the Brexit Select Committee, and it turns out that of the members of that committee, 2-1 are arch Remainers and are doing everything they possibly can to keep Project Fear alive and keep us in the EU. These people were elected by the British people. So she's done an amazing thing. She's resigned her post in government, the greasy pole. She slid back down, and she's going to put all her efforts into trying to ensure that the government does the thing that they were elected to do. Now, I move on to a league table where, ha ha ha, yet again, the United Kingdom is at the bottom of the table. So what's new? Ha! Plucky United Kingdom. We'll do well when we Brexit. You think? Ha! 0. That's the number of points we get. That's the number we get in this table. What is this table? Well, it's a number of school shootings since 2009. For goodness sake, United Kingdom, you can't get it right. You haven't got a single school shooting since 2009. Yet again, United Kingdom, I congratulate you. And alongside us at the bottom are Spain, Australia, Switzerland, Japan, Netherlands, and the Argies. Great. Only slightly above on the table are Russia, Germany has got one, Greece and China. So out of 1.3 billion people, they've had one school shooting in 9 years. With two school shootings slightly higher up the table, we've got those wonderful free market libertarians who clearly hate all the immigration so much that they take in so many, France and quasi-France, Canada, with two school shootings in the last 9 years. India, with the same population or so as China, has had five. South Africa, that wonderful capitalist state, libertarian, live and let live, not at all racist. South Africa has had six school shootings since 2009. And Mexico, for whom HSBC money laundered for drug cartels, has had just under one school shooting per year since 2009. There's a country I haven't yet mentioned which you might be thinking about. Top of the league is the United States of America. Da da dee 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 dee, la da 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 dee. They must be so proud standing to the Star Spangled Banner with their fist punched against their left breasts. When they listen to that, how many of them are thinking of all the school shootings since 2009? Mexico was 8. Many do you think the US has had? 18? 88, 188. No, the US has had 288 school shootings in the last 9 years. And they tell me it's not because anyone can get a gun. You couldn't make it up, could you? One of the funniest stories to come out last week was the New York parents who had to go to court to evict their 30-year-old layabout, lazy, good-for-nothing loser son who refused to move out. Middle-class people, middle-class kid, couldn't be bothered. Court documents say that Michael Rotondo does not pay rent or help with chores. Have you done your chores yet? What chores? Oh, great, thanks, I'll have a pint. And has ignored his parents' offers of money. $1,100 they were going to give him to get him settled. They gave him 5 eviction notices. He gave him a final date. It was ignored. Do you know what he's doing now? He's appealing the judge's decision. What a total loser. Okay. Bigger picture stuff. China has been lending on the quiet, you know. Billions and billions of the equivalent of US dollars to developing nations. Prompting concerns by the right on lefties and people who love the state and the media that the terms and indeed existence of this debt leaves the emerging market countries in much worse positions than many realise, because they're now debtors to China. Dun, dun, dun. Anyone ever heard of the World Bank? It's what the World Bank has been doing for the last 60 years. Why do you think Africa is the way it is? In South America. Not entirely South America. Okay. Every so often I've mentioned about how amazing Amazon is and also how problematic Amazon is. Well, here's a couple of things. They have, as you know, cultivated over the years an image as a very hugely customer-friendly company. Partly because, you know, you can send back anything that even you don't want, never mind that it's faulty. I even heard someone say to me they bought a garden hammock thing, no, a garden sofa that swings. I don't know how to explain it. And there was a piece when it was sent to them that was a bit bent. They phoned up customer services and Amazon simply said, "We'll send you a new one." "Well, what about the one you sent us? Do you not want it back?" "Oh, well, it's more expensive to pick it up and take it away. We'll just send you a new one," which is quite astonishing. That happened last year. However, Amazon have now changed their procedures. They have started to ban shoppers who are making too many returns. Now, you might think, well, that's good business, blah, 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 and I'm sure it is. But it's an example of monopolistic behaviour. You know what they've done to get where they are? Well, it seems to me they seem very comfortable with where they are now. And it strikes me they're open to competition. I mentioned Walmart a couple of months ago. Walmart is likely to compete against Amazon And again, to remind you, Walmart owns Asda in the UK. And this is, you know, this just drives me crazy, and I'm not at all surprised. I'm not at all shocked. One of my girls asked me, why don't we get an Alexa, one of those little devices that you put in the kitchen table and it listens to you, and you're meant to be able to ask it questions, it'll play your music, it will set up a reserve a table at a restaurant and all this kind of lovely stuff. A Portland, Oregon family contacted Amazon to investigate after they say a private conversation in their home was recorded by Amazon's Alexa, the voice-controlled smart computer, and sent the discussion to someone on their contact list. Well, I don't even need to tell you the potential ramifications if there'd been anything at all indiscreet, dodgy or whatever in that discussion. And don't give me the argument, well, if you don't do anything dodgy, then there's nothing to be concerned about. Excuse me, the relationship we should have with the state is that the state should leave us alone unless we actively break their, sometimes their nonsense laws. They should not be listening into us, and certainly private companies. I said to our girl, we will never, in my lifetime, we will never have such a device. And then the following day, I thought to myself, you're an idiot, Jonathan Davis. You're carrying one in your pocket. And you can't get away from it. Now, I know that it's months away from Christmas and some of you are still getting over from last Christmas. But listen to this. And the public service announcement, you should know that the what you're about to hear may be damaging to your eardrums. He's making a list. He's checking it twice. He's gonna find out who's naughty or nice. Santa Claus is in contravention of Article 4 of the General Data Protection Regulation EU 2016/679. Have you seen that movie, Notting Hill, with Hugh Grant and Julia Roberts? She's an A-grade Hollywood, $15 million a science fiction movie actress. He's a down-at-heel travel bookshop owner. And they fall in love and they fall out of love. And then one of the great scenes of all time in movies, she's in the bookshop and she says to him, I'm just a girl standing in front of a boy, asking him to sign this GDPR consent form. Oh, dear. Then this other film where they land on a desert island and they find a message in a bottle and they open it up and they think we're saved. And it says, do you still want to receive our emails? I am fed up with GDPR. If I never hear the phrase GDPR again, I will be a very happy chappy. Unfortunately, I'm sure I will still hear about it. Another blooming nonsense EU regulation which just cost money. And it's a prime example of why big business, big banking loves the EU. Because the EU is all about regulations, the lowest common denominator. It's not about the ease of doing business. And the harder you make business to do, what you're doing is you're putting more and more weight onto SMEs, small and medium-sized enterprises. Because those of us in the SME sector, which is by far the biggest sector, the wealth-generating sector in a semi-quasi-capitalist economy. We spend an inordinate amount of time, energy, and money fulfilling their blooming regulations. Whereas the big multinationals, the big banks, they spend a tiny, tiny proportion of their revenues and of their time on these matters. It's nothing to them to spend, I don't know, £10 million on fulfilling these stupid regulations. It's not even a drop in the ocean of the size of these companies when you think of the billions and billions that they rake in every year. That's why they love the EU and why they love big government, because it gets rid of the competition. Talking about the EU, I read, you know, apparently Theresa May and Hammond and the Remainers, disgusting people, they're telling us that we can't have Brexit. In other words, we have to stay in the customs union or the customs partnership, whatever they want to call it. In other words, staying in the EU. And we have to do it because of the Irish and Northern Irish border. Well, you should know the following. 65% of Ulster's trade is internal. Do I have to say that means Northern Ireland? 20% goes to the rest of the UK. Only 5% of Northern Ireland trade goes to the Republic of Ireland. Only 1.5% of the Republic of Ireland's trade goes to Northern Ireland. And only 1.6% of its imports comes from Northern Ireland. There are 13,000 border crossings used annually for Guinness. There's no way on earth that the so-called border between Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland should be the reason for remaining in the EU. Absolute, utter codswallop. Deutsche Bank, by far the largest bank in Europe. It's making 7,000 bankers unemployed. The bulk of them are in London. What do you call 7,000 fewer bankers? A start. It sounds to me like within 6 or 12 months, we're likely to see another 2,000 or 3,000 London homes come on the market as these people decide to go and live around the country, because they realise there's no future in banking now, and they've made a fortune on their house. They've made a fortune full stop. So, hey, let's go and retire at the age of 40. Well, you know, there comes a point when there are so many houses for sale in London that prices start falling. And indeed, I've been doing some research using land registry statistics. Land registry, for those who don't know, it's actual sale prices. It's not hearsay. It's not opinion. It's not made up stats. It's actual sale prices. London house prices have been falling for nearly a year. Indeed, the exclusive, the likes of Hammersmith and Fulham, they peaked, get this, 3 years ago. There are now over 30,000 newly built properties in London which they cannot sell. There's a problem in the London market, of that there is no doubt. Bring it on is what I say. And around the country, it's practically as flat as a pancake. Yes, prices are rising marginally, but volumes of transactions have been falling materially. And, well, we'll see this year if we are now in an era of rising interest rates. We'll know this year. Within economics, it was reported about what was going on in Scotland to do with the guy, I can't remember his name, Jim something, who's the founder and CEO of Ineos, which is a major energy company. Wasn't it mentioned he's now the richest person in the country? Maybe he is, I don't know. I'm just going to quote the couple of paragraphs. We were astonished to learn during proceedings that the Scottish government claims that it has not issued a fracking ban in Scotland, and indeed there may never be one. The position of the Scottish government that has now been stated in court represents a staggering U-turn on the policy direction announced by the Energy Minister during parliamentary debate in October 2017, and by the First Minister, Sturgeon, when she said in Parliament, quote, Scotland should welcome the fact that fracking in Scotland is banned, unquote. The Scottish people in Parliament may find this revelation barely believable, when the government has repeatedly told Holyrood that there is an effective and immediate ban. In other words, the Scottish government is a total socialist joke. Time and time again, they say in Parliament, there is no fracking ban. Sorry, there is a fracking ban, and there will always be a fracking ban. Then Ineos guy takes them to court, and they say, we've never had a ban on fracking. Don't believe socialists. What's his name? Grayling, in the government transport secretary, is that his name? He's renationalised the East Coast Rail Line. The state owns the rail lines. The state owns the stations. The state regulates the industry and always has done. The state controls ticket prices and always has done. The state leases the use of the line to private businesses. Private businesses drive the trains, you think? And they say that privatisation has failed. It's exactly like the energy industry, the so-called freedom to go to whichever company you want to buy your heating and lighting, not with all the controls and regulations by government. There, you think there's been privatization? You're joking. So we're told that since 1850, every decade except the current one has had a recession. That's from the US. Well, you know, normally I would say, therefore, every decade should have a recession. It seems reasonable. But, you know, when you think about it, so what? Just because it's happened, five, 15, 16 out of 16 times, it's like tossing a coin. Just because you get heads every time, 16 times, there's an equal chance of getting heads or tails on the 17th time. And it will always be so. Just because we've had a recession every decade doesn't actually mean we have to have one. And we're not going to have one this year. And there are still very few indications that we're going to have one in 2019. And then, of course, we're into a new decade. Well, we'll see. I'm not going to do the why is Israel such a success right now? Maybe another time. From economics, we move on to markets. Well, you know, on my Twitter account, the podcast Twitter account, but my Twitter account, which is Jonathan Davis, where the O is a zero, I did some charts today and I sent them out. I'm just digging them up as I'm speaking. So the first one I want to look at, and you can go onto the Twitter account, you'll see them. I did them about 11 o'clock this morning. The first one is actually a pinned tweet, and it's pinned onto a thread of tweets. I've been following the US dollar most of this year. The dollar absolutely tanked in 2017, which massively helped emerging markets, commodities, and indeed global stocks. And everyone and his dog in January, February, March was still massively, massively bearish on the US dollar. I saw the chart had indications by February, March, that it might be reversing from falling to flattening to, well, we would see. And sure enough, it did it. And indeed, it's been soaring since mid-April. So that's several weeks, actually. It's gone up. I'm looking at it something like 5 or 6%. This is huge in such a short space of time for the world's most important currency. And sure enough, a rising dollar has finally had a negative effect on oil, which has pulled back from, what, $72, $73 into the mid to high 60s. I've been saying for months the dollar is in a bull market. It can pull back at any time, but it's still in a bull market. It can pull back to $64, $65 all the way down from $73, and it's still in a bull market. Just because a thing falls doesn't make the trend suddenly change. Much more has to happen to a market before we say the trend has finally changed. I'm talking about the medium-term trend. I'm not interested in the hour-by-hour trend, the day-by-day trend. I'm almost not even interested in the week-to-week trend. I'm talking about the intermediate trend, in other words, many, many weeks, indeed months, indeed maybe a couple of years. That's an intermediate term. So the dollar chart remains bullish, and I've been saying that the gold bugs need to be cooling themselves, and sure enough, all the way from 1360, it went down to about 1275 or so. It's been into 1305. It's currently, I think, 1295 or so. The dollar and gold do have an inverse correlation, certainly in the short term. And as the dollar continues to rise, which it probably will do, although this is a short week because we have a bank holiday in the UK and the US, the dollar should still rise until going into in mid-June. As I've said, we've got the FOMC meeting where they're very likely, I think it's almost a given now, they're going to raise interest rates again. That could be the point, actually, when the dollar starts reversing back down again from its, at a high at the beginning of 2017. It went into a low in January of 18, so nearly, just over a year of falls, risen for the last few months. I can see it rising for another couple of weeks or so, and then I could see it falling again in the long-term bear market. But for now, the dollar remains up. So be careful, commodity bulls, in the short term, long term, nothing's changed. I tweeted the global energy shares chart. everyone's bearish. I don't understand it. That is a really bullish chart, medium to long term. Global stocks. I don't understand why people are bearish. It's a bullish chart, medium to long term. Uranium miners. It's up 100% over the last 2 years. Might we get 1,000% over the next 5 to 10? Greek stocks, broadly similar. And I also tweeted emerging markets. It's a normal pullback in what's probably a multi-year bull market. Everyone's listening to the stories, the narrative, the economists' opinion, their prejudices, and also what the bankers have told the media to tell you, because the bankers want you to sell this stuff so that they can buy this stuff. That's why you're getting negative stuff in the media. I've also finally tweeted about a stock by the name of, well, it goes under the handle, the ticker, OSTK. The stock is called Overstock. Anyone knows anything about the blockchain and the Bitcoin stuff should know about Overstock. It's still a bearish chart, but Overstock is a very, very interesting company, and it has the potential, get this, Overstock has the potential to become the Amazon of Wall Street. Not that it'll sell stuff like Amazon sells stuff, but that Overstock, from very small beginnings, has the potential to transform the global financial landscape, as Amazon has with retail. The chart is still bearish, but I suspect Overstock is a company we will be hearing a lot about over the next few years and beyond. We're seeing we're seeing sectors going to all-time highs. Small caps are back to all-time highs. Regional banks are back to all-time highs. Technology stocks are approaching new all-time highs from their spring dip. And indeed, financials are doing well as part of global stocks. Financials are doing well, and no wonder. The Senate, the Congress, should I say, passed a bill to ease regulations of banks. They're loosening federal regulations on the banking sector, and this is huge. It doesn't matter the right or wrong, and that's where many investors go wrong. They invest with their morals, and they invest with what the BBC, Bloomberg, the Times and the Telegraph and the FT tell them what to do. No, invest in what's going to make money. If you're in it for morals, then you ain't an investor. Banks are going to make huge amounts of money. Quotes of the week. Before I get to them, I remind you that the Booms and Busts report, which is an email document that I send out free of charge. If you're not on the list to receive it, send me your email address to jd@theboomsandbustsshow.com. jd@theboomsandbustsshow.com. You really want to be on the list for the Booms and Busts report. I said months ago that I would tell you what Milton Friedman said as to what government really should be. Government over the last 100 years has grown leaps and bounds. We have big government. We have big state. You know, 100 years ago, federal taxes were 3%. They're now 30%. I mean, it's an absolute joke. And they're still borrowing vast amounts of money because they can't afford the state. This will turn into massive inflation over the longer term. And inflation, remember, listener, is the biggest tax of all. Milton Friedman said, government has three primary functions. It should provide for military defence of the nation. It should enforce contracts between individuals. It should protect citizens from crimes against themselves or their property. When government, in pursuit of good intentions, tries to rearrange the economy, legislate morality, or help special interests, the cost come in inefficiency, lack of motivation, and loss of freedom. Government should be a referee, not an active player. I want to finish off by saying that we went to the Duxford International Air Show yesterday. The sun was shining. It was about 25, 27 degrees. It was absolutely beautiful. I've never been to an air show in my life, and I'm glad that I did for the first time. It was absolutely magnificent. We saw biplanes, we saw triplanes, we saw training planes with propellers, we saw the French equivalent of the Red Arrows, Les Flèches Rouges, and if you believe that, you'll believe anything. They were absolutely spectacular. We were fortunate. We got to go inside the original Concorde. Can you imagine that? We were actually inside the Concorde that they made to test the machine. It was incredible. It was actually a spectacular day. And this follows on from last week when I was talking about 717 Squadron, the Dambusters. It was very emotional. The absolute summit was the few minutes where we saw the Spitfire, the original Mark I Spitfire, flying around doing somersaults and whatever. It was very emotional, an amazing day, and we will be there again next year. It was an absolutely fantastic day. And on the other hand, I think the third display was from a modern French jet fighter. Why they got an affinity with the French, I don't know. There were Americans there as well as Brits. But this jet fighter was as sleek and pointy as you can imagine any jet fighter would be. And my God, the noise as it went past. And this was subsonic, and the way it could twist and turn and do somersaults, and the destructive power of one machine. Now put an artificial intelligence inside it. I repeat, has no one ever watched a dystopian science fiction movie? I hope you've enjoyed the Booms and Bus Show, podcast number 54. I've had a blast. I'll see you next week.